shut up and sit down.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to the DwnFwdPUNCHcast, episode 3. I'm your host, Jason. This is my partner in crime here, Tover. And David, our other piece of the pyramid here, he's
AWOL.
He couldn't be with us today. Couldn't be with us, and just out of respect, I'd like to give him a little moment of silence if we could. So,
this is getting way more somber than it needs to be. He's in a better place, but it's
he's
just not
a better place.
Here.
He's at work.
Oh, okay,
so well. He's not in a better place. So David, we are sorry that we missed you, but he'll be with us again next episode. A lot of good stuff today. Today we're going to talk about privacy in video games. Maybe a little bit about the PlayStation Vita and whether Sony should do another one or not, and if that decision is affected by the Switch at all. And because it's Valentine's Day coming up, I figured we'll do something a little bit fun, and we're going to do some video game pickup lines, which you're going to want to hear, so make sure you stick around. What are you playing these days?
Just this week, I started a playthrough of 2015 Game of the Year, The Witcher 3, Wild Hunt.
I have never played any of The Witchers.
I didn't play the first Witcher. I tried to play the second Witcher. Because I bought it on Steam for like $3.
And those Steam sales are so easy to get sucked into, aren't they?
Exactly. So I bought it for super cheap, but I don't have like a gaming PC. I just have like a laptop, so I couldn't really run it. So I just, like 15 minutes in, I was like, all right, well, this is a failed experiment. But The Witcher 3, I mean, I don't have, if you're watching this, like, I don't have to tell you that it's a good game. I mean, that game, you know, was met with so much critical acclaim that it, like, it'd be pretty redundant for me to be like, yeah, it turns out it's good. Like, everybody knows it's good. It's good. But, yeah, but that's what I've been playing.
It's like, all
right. Yeah, right. Yeah. That's what I've been playing. Because, yeah, I just got started on that. It's fun. It's great.
Cool.
What about you?
You know...
Are you playing Halo?
I haven't played much Halo.
All right.
Honestly, like, you know, there hasn't been any new things lately that I feel like I need to be playing. I've been mostly in a holding pattern until Breath of the Wild. So I figured it was a good time to kind of go back on my back catalog and see what I can get completed, or at least play a little bit more of.
Yeah.
So I was doing a little bit, I've mostly been playing Transformers Devastation. I don't know if you played that.
Okay. I've played it a very little bit, but not much, but what I played was pretty cool.
There's things I like about it and things that I don't. So last week we were talking about Scalebound, Platinum Games. That's the same company same developer that makes Transformers Devastation. And the fact that the game plays like the 1987 original G1 series, I don't know if 87 is the right year, but it plays like the original cartoon, which is really cool. It sounds like a lot of the same actors. I don't know if it actually is the same cast or they just got really good copycats. But that, as somebody who just has an unbelievable fandom for Transformers, I enjoy that very thoroughly. The gameplay, like the actual like mechanics of the game are a little wonky at times. And sometimes the game decides to go into FU mode is what I call it. Because to give you an example, right now I'm at a part where the chapter I'm in, I had to go like, take down a bunch of generators. And at each generator, there was a Constructicon. And I had to fight them. That's fine, whatever. When I get to the end, the very end of the level, I have to face Devastator, who's guarding like the big generator. Right. So all the Constructicons that come, they farm Devastator. Now, he's considerably bigger. I have the choice of playing through a couple people. So I'm Optimus Prime, obviously. And I'm fighting Devastator. He's much bigger. And when you try to go through, like, it takes forever to kill these guys. And all of a sudden, like, you'll be halfway through, you're making a lot of progress, and then he just decides that he's going to jump, and wherever I am on the map, he's going to land on me, and he's just going to toss me around like a ragdoll until I'm dead. And I can't get out of it. Like, I am stuck. It pigeonholes you and just destroys you. And that is not fun.
Okay.
So I don't enjoy that. But I'm sticking to it for now. I've also been playing some Sega CD, or not Sega CD, Sonic CD.
Okay.
That was originally on the Sega.
It's like, where'd you even find a Sega CD?
Yeah. I've never played through a Sonic game. I've played some occasionally, okay. but I never owned a Genesis. You know, I had friends when I was little that had it, and Sonic was fun. And I think Xbox Live had like a sale where I got Sonic CD for $1. So nice. How could you go wrong, really?
Sure, yeah.
So I've been doing that, and that's fun. Yeah, but that's mostly it. It's been good times.
Okay, I gotta say, for at least in terms of Transformers games, I have played the two. I think it was the same company that did Devastation, although I'm not 100% sure. But there was War for Cybertron and Fall of Cybertron.
I've heard those are good.
They are pretty good. But they're different from Devastation a lot in terms of style. Like, they're still based on the Gen 1 characters, but it's, you know, everything's designed to look a little bit more modern. But it's supposed to not only be canon, but it's supposed to be, like, well, I guess that's exactly what I mean. It's supposed to be canon in terms of, like, a prequel leading up to Gen 1, which is interesting, but I think that it can also be maybe a little touchy to do that for certain fans, you know, to kind of, like,
mess with the
30, how many years later from that show, you know.
30-something, I'm sure.
Yeah, so. But anyway, Transformers games, lately, they've been doing pretty good with those. So that's cool. I'm glad to hear you're playing Devastation, because it seems pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, how can you go wrong? Even if the game's terrible, if you get to transform back and forth or run around as a Transformer.
Yeah, that's cool. A win right there.
And if I get to play as Grimlock, I may lose my mind.
That if you want to play as Grimlock, I think it was War for Cybertron, the second of the two past Transformers games. Man, they do the Dinobots real good. Grimlock, sick.
No joke. If I end up getting to play as Grimlock on the show, I may do a podcast, because it's going to just happen. I'm going to get trapped in it. It's not going to be intentional, but I may end up doing an episode of the podcast in the Grimlock voice. Because once you start going with the, me, Grimlock, king of dinosaurs, you know,
right.
It's very hard to break that. Yeah. Just like a Mario voice. I don't know if you ever, have you ever got caught in the Mario
for
voice?
For weeks at a time. Oh, sometimes it's like, it's unbelievable. Unhealthy. Yeah.
You just start just walking around, especially if you're feeding off somebody and you're just walking around like, oh no, who left the dishes out? Like, you could do that for a month.
Yeah. Gotta be careful then.
Yeah.
So Grimlock, maybe making a guest appearance the next PunchCast. Who knows? Who's to say? We don't know
yet.
For
the sake of our we'll listeners. See. I hope not. But
we'll see.
For the sake of my inner childhood Jason, I sure hope so.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's, we're gonna take a break in just a moment here and then get into the news topics we wanted to. But there's a lot of, like, really little news stories that, you know, I didn't figure was appropriate for the segment itself. But I don't know if you've heard this, but did you know that Link has a last name?
I not only did I not know that, but I kind of refused to believe that. I
mean, Miyamoto told everybody. So Game Informer.
Is it his own last name?
Just wait. Game Informer.
Okay.
Did an interview with him and the producer of the Legend of Zelda series. I forget what his name is. And he confirmed that Link's name, full name, is Link Link.
Link Link.
Link Link.
So in the same vein of like the Super Mario Brothers movie, where yes. It was Mario Mario and Luigi Mario, clearly we didn't learn any lessons from that. Link Link is what we went with.
Quick side note, that's even worse in the movie, because the two Mario brothers in the movie, one being English, the other one being Puerto Rican, and they're both playing Italian guys for some reason. But it's ridiculous that the two of them can't even say their name the same. Like, one of them says Mario and the other one says Mario. They're like, yeah, who are you? I'm like, I'm Mario Mario, and I'm Luigi Mario. I'm like, what? Like, make up your minds.
Boy.
But yes, he says it's Link Link. And actually, what's funny, you bring up the Super Mario Brothers movie, because originally when that movie came out, I think it was Miyamoto that said that was just written for the movie and that wasn't actually their last name. But since then, has said that they have adopted it as the Mario Brothers, Mario Mario, Luigi Mario.
That's just insane. I'm not into that. I'm not into that.
I mean, what do you want his last name to be?
Not Cavatelli? Mario.
Mario Cavatelli.
I would be more into that. I mean, you can't. That's a way better last name than Mario Mario.
What about Link? If you could choose a last name for Link.
Oh, man. If I could choose. I thought you were going to say something like Hylian, which I don't think would have made a whole lot of sense canonically. Because, I mean, is he technically like a Hyrulean Maybe sometimes. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it, with Link, it's a technically like a different Link almost every time. Not every time, because we know it's the same one from Ocarina and Majora, but it's, sometimes.
It's actually interesting that you bring that up, because I've actually been reading a lot about this lately. And I don't know if you know, but Nintendo recently dropped like a anniversary book with, and said that all of these Legend of Zelda storylines are connected. Were you aware of this?
Well,
like it's one, like it used to be, like people originally thought that it was a series of different stories that always featured a Link and a Zelda.
Sure.
And that sometimes they were the same characters, and other times it was like the descendants of or whatever. Apparently they all fit into one canon. But at the Ocarina of Time, it splits into three different realities.
Okay.
So at the end of Ocarina of Time, you have one reality that splits, because at the end of the game, Zelda sends Link back in time. He fights Ganon, he wins, you beat the game, and she sends Spoilers. Him back to when he's... Yeah, if you haven't played Ocarina of Time, you should have already done that already.
Yeah, really. That's on you.
I think I own the game. I think I own three versions of that game, and I've played it probably four or five times. Anyway, so it splits. So there's one scenario where the story takes off from Link as a kid, and you finish stories as Kid Link, which are some of the games, like Wind Waker is a Kid Link progression. Then there is a adult Link story where you follow adult Link, which I think Twilight Princess is part of. And then there's another one where you fail, where you die fighting Ganon. And there's a story of like a reincarnated Link, and I forget how they split which games go under that line. But there's three timelines, and I think that the failed Link story is the shortest one maybe so far. But it's interesting. It's very convoluted. It's very confusing. Yeah. But it's interesting if you ever have the time to look it up and read into it.
So basically, boil down, it's just who knows.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Who's to say? There's too much.
Honestly, what it is that they made a bunch of games and they didn't intend on linking them together.
Sure.
And then they decided that they were going to, because people were doing it anyways, trying to find connections. Like, some of them, I think some of them did, because you had, obviously, the first Legend of Zelda game, and then, what was the second one called? The
Link's Awakening?
No, it was like the Story of Link or the something. It wasn't Link's Awakening. It was something else of Link. Anyways, that was a direct follow-up. Majora's Mask, a direct follow-up to Ocarina of Time. Like, some of them are supposed to be together, but they just decided to kind of weave them together in general, which is cool. You know, you kind of have to suspend disbelief a little bit, but whatever. Other than that, because I know you're a big Marvel fan, have you heard the news about Marvel?
Oh, not only am I a big Marvel fan, but I'm also a big fan of Square Enix, because they make Kingdom Hearts, which is my favorite gaming franchise of all time, Final Fantasy, which I'm a huge fan of. So if I'm correct, and assuming this is what you're referring to, it's that Marvel has made a multi-game, multi-year contract, plan,
an
timeline.
MVGU. Right? A Marvel video game universe.
And I am just thrilled, because like Square Enix makes games I love, Marvel makes a ton of stuff I love, so that's just like, that's just awesome.
Well, and they're incorporating other studios too. Like, I know Crystal Dynamics is part of this endeavor, and I think different studios are doing different parts of the games, because I don't think you can have one group work all these games.
Sure. Well, Square Enix publishes Dynamics, a lot of games.
Yeah, yeah.
Though,
so. Square Enix, I think, is publishing them, and these individual studios are building them.
Yeah. Yes.
Crystal Dynamics did Rise of the Tomb Raider, which I don't know if you've played, but I played it through, and it's fantastic.
Okay.
I would play literally anything Crystal Dynamics threw at me at this point. Like, after playing that, like, the whole thing was done so well. I'm glad it's a Marvel property, but if they were like, hey, we're going to make a Dogbert game, I'd be like, that's a little weird, but you know what? I'll give it a whirl.
Wow. Wow. That's a bold statement.
Yeah. Like, that's exciting, right?
Yeah, I'm super really into that.
I don't know. Do you know if the Telltale thing is not part of that, right? I know that that's not Square Enix, but the Guardians of the Galaxy Telltale game, is that part of the video game universe?
I would say no, it's not, because I also know that Insomniac's upcoming Spider-Man game is not linked to this either.
Okay.
Which is interesting to me. I don't know if that means that they'll have Square Enix labeled Spider-Man games that will work in. I have to imagine they're going to. But maybe the Insomniac thing just got started like before this was really planned out.
Maybe.
So, and maybe the ball is already rolling on that and they're just like, so whatever.
Maybe they're starting with the Avengers game then?
Probably.
Because that trailer, I'm sure you saw the trailer, right?
The teaser of just like a couple little things?
Yeah, like the teaser thing.
Yeah.
To me, it sounds like they're starting it where the Avengers have fallen, and I don't know if they're looking for new Avengers or if you have to somehow regroup the Avengers from the movies. Obviously, there's been lots of Avengers in the comic books over the years, but it seems like the mass known Avengers have fallen, and that you're doing something to kind of put an Avengers team back together, which is kind of interesting.
Who knows?
Video game or comic book video games historically have not worked well in most cases. I mean, you have the Arkham series, which is an exception.
Sure.
But I have played a lot of bad comic book games.
Yeah, that's fair. There's been a lot of comic book games, and there's been a lot of bad comic book games. But I think now we're seeing better.
Can you think of any comic book game that worked besides a Batman property? Like, I mean, I feel like a lot of characters are hard to adapt to a video game.
I've played some Wolverine games. I played a PlayStation 2 Wolverine game, I think called Weapon X, which was like, it was good but not great. There was some stealth and action. It was good but not great. There was Origins, Wolverine Origins, which was based off the movie.
I think I played some of that, and it was not so good.
It was very God of War, which at the time was like everybody was into that type of game. Like, there was a ton of God of War clones coming out at that time. But so again, like, I would say that one was probably like okay, but not great. The Hulk had his Ultimate Destruction game, which I think was on the Xbox and the PlayStation 2. And even though that's not like an excellent game, it was fun to play because you're just the Hulk and you just like F up a city, you know.
Yeah, I mean, smash cars and stuff is...
That works pretty good.
Wait, maybe I did play that. Like, you throw cars and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this sounds vaguely familiar now. I feel like it had like a Rampage kind of vibe to it.
Kind
Not
of.
Exactly. Like,
right, but the destruction element was there, sure.
Yeah, like you're... Like, that's, like maybe the... I think there was a Rampage somewhere on the N64 that was not the traditional like climb up the buildings thing. It was like walk around more of a sandbox.
Okay.
Unless I'm thinking of a different property, but I feel like it was kind
of
like that.
It was War of the Monsters.
Maybe that cool. That's what I'm thinking of, War of the Monsters. Was it kind of like War of the Monsters?
Kind of, but Hulk's not quite as big as those characters were, okay. But like otherwise, yeah, it was, I mean, you know, it was pretty similar.
Hmm.
Also, Ultimate Spider-Man on the original Xbox and PlayStation 2, that was a great comic book game.
Really?
Yes. You play as Spider-Man and Venom. There's two stories that you kind of go through, and I loved that game.
You're a big Spider-Man and Venom fan, too, though.
Yeah, I am. So, I mean, maybe there's a little bit of bias there, but I thought that worked really well, and the art style was excellent. It was, like, cel-shaded. It looked very much like the Ultimate Spider-Man comics at that time.
Wolf Among Us, too. That's a comic book. I like that a lot. But that's a Telltale game. That's kind of different than a genre.
That's very narrative driven, but yeah, that I love that game. It's good.
I just remember there was like a Superman game on N64 that was really bad.
We don't need to talk about that.
There was a bunch of Spider-Man games that swung and missed.
Spider-Man movie games. I mean, I think a lot of people hold Spider-Man 2 in high regard, but I don't know. Spider-Man movie games never really did it for me.
Yeah. Well, that's what we've been playing, and a little more. We're gonna take a short break, and when we come back, we're gonna get into the news. See you in a bit. And we're back. Did you miss us? Because I missed us.
I missed you. You
were here. Had to make it weird. Just a little bit. But that's all right.
Anyway.
All right, so... I don't know if you heard, but this happened a while back, and I can't remember exactly the timeline. I want to say it was close to a year, maybe a little bit under a year. Vizio, the company that makes televisions.
Yeah.
So they have smart TV, and people started noticing that while the smart TV was even not in use, there was like a little light on it that was usually shown when you were watching something. There was a light that was going off even when you weren't watching something, like the TV would be off and this little light would be doing something. So some very tech-savvy people decided to do whatever tech-savvy people do with computers.
Mm-hmm.
And they made the determination that the television was sending data back to Vizio, and they were able to figure out it was telling Vizio all about what people were watching. So, like, it was telling, like, the kind of shows that you would watch, the channels, how often, like, all these different things. And it turns out that Vizio was selling this information to third parties for advertising and things like that. So a bunch of people called them out on it, and they swore up and down that it was not specific enough to tell who the individual person was, but it did narrow it down to, like, zip code and region and, like, general vicinity.
Wow.
And a lot of people were not thrilled about this. So it was just, I think, I want to say Monday, maybe Tuesday. It was this week that a court ruling finally came down, and Vizio now has to pay like 340,000 people or something like that. They have to settle. It's $2.2 million that I think that they are that they are paying as a lump sum. Now, obviously, that gets divvied out amongst right. everybody. Lawyers get a bunch, and all these people are probably walking around with like 50 or 75 cents.
Right.
But it brings up an interesting thing, because companies do this a lot, right? I mean, data is like a huge moneymaker for companies now. You think about all the advertisements that you get in your inbox from
yeah.
your email, and when you're searching on the web and Facebook and all these other things in there. Where do you stand on where your privacy should be? Like, are you comfortable with companies collecting like this non-specific data? Or does it make you a little weirded out?
Where do I stand personally?
Yeah, yeah.
Personally, I don't think it bothers me as much as maybe it should. Because I just kind of don't care. It's weird to me, I think, in this case of Vizio. Like, it just seems like such a strange company to be doing something like that. So, like, that makes me kind of step back, I guess. But
now, Vizio is not the only company that does this.
Well,
I want to say it was LG, Samsung. There's lots of television makers that do this.
Really?
The difference is that it is an opt-in or opt-out program.
Okay.
Vizio, like, these other manufacturers, they will make you aware of it and you opt into it.
Okay.
Vizio was doing this without telling anybody, and it was a setting, and you could turn the setting off, but it was on by default. So when
okay.
you pull it out of the box, you don't even know what's going on. You set up your TV, and it's just doing it.
Sure.
Now, in the cases of like other things, like when I look at things like email or my Facebook feed, that data gets used for the purposes of advertisements. I have always kind of looked at it from the standpoint of, well, I would rather look at an advertisement for something I'm interested in than something that I am not a consumer of. You want to throw a video game advertisement in front of me? Great. You want to show me a tampon commercial? You're not helping anybody, right? I mean, you're not helping the company because I'm not going to go buy your product. You're not helping me because you're just annoying me that I got to watch it. And I'm not doing anything that like I need to be ashamed of, where like I'm like, oh no, now they know that I'm going to DwnFwdPUNCH.com and it's not there because the site's down. So I'm not doing anything that like it's weird about, but
sure.
I like having, like, I like knowing that it's happening.
Yeah. Okay. And that's fair. I think I'm not bothered by the sources that I just would naturally expect it from. Like I use a lot of Google products, and I'm sure they're collecting metadata or whatever for who knows what. Facebook. I mean, if you use Facebook, you need to be aware that you're pretty much signing your soul away to the devil in a digital privacy type of way. So, I mean, it happens everywhere. Everybody is doing it, and maybe that's just like why I don't care about it too much.
I just want to know about it. Like, just don't.
Yeah, no, but that's a good point. That's a good point.
And I think that's the most disturbing part. Now, I guess to tie this into video games, I mean, cameras are being used more and
yeah.
more everywhere, right?
True.
You know, like, I have a Kinect.
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you have a PlayStation camera?
I do.
So you have a PlayStation camera. The DS has got a camera on it. It might even have a couple on it.
That's
I think
three.
For the 3D. Does it have three?
It's got a front-facing and two rear-facing, so technically three.
It's got two rear-facing?
It's got a capture in 3D, so it needs two.
Why would that be rear-facing? Shouldn't those be front-facing?
No. If you're videoing something, you want
to... Oh, to capture it that way. I thought you meant for the 3D while you're playing a game.
Okay.
Our phones, obviously, laptops. I mean, things have cameras all over the place. But going back to video games, is there a line? Like, does that enrich the experience, or does it start to become that weird Big Brother effect for you?
Well, I mean, it depends what they're doing. I mean, is somebody at Sony watching me play my games through my PlayStation camera when I'm not aware of it? Now, personally, you know, I hope they are, because I spend a lot of time just completely nude in front of my TV. And if somebody has to see that, I think that's kind of funny. Now, should they...
I just imagine that some Sony exec there, and I'm picturing like that guy from the commercials that they ran like early 2000s. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah,
he was a suit, and he was like that real sarcastic, dry humor kind of guy. And just like, man, this guy really likes this game. How do you know? Look at him. He clearly really likes it. What is he playing? Knack. It's very bizarre, but he is fully engaged. If you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Or maybe just somebody scrolling through a bunch of feeds, like just in like a shady room, you know, and they're just like scrolling through a bunch of PlayStation camera feeds, you know, just trying to collect information. And then they come to me and I'm just like spread eagle, full frontal playing Tricky Towers or something. Oh, and they're just like, oh, God! And, you know, and it's just...
Yeah, that's quite the image.
It takes, you know, who knows? I don't know. Do I really hope that's happening? No. And I also don't think that that's happening. I don't think there's anybody accessing those feeds without our knowledge. Could I be wrong? Yeah, I could, but like I don't suspect that that's what's happening.
So with the case for like the Kinect, for example, I know originally, I forget who had the quote, but they were originally talking to some exec there. I don't remember if it was Phil Spencer at the time or somebody else, but they were talking about the things that it could do in theory. Like it could be used for marketing research and that kind of thing, and they were trying to make the case of like how sophisticated the technology was, not necessarily what they planned to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
And they made the point that like you can, if they wanted to, they would be able to pull data like your heart rate as you're watching something to see like what really gets your interest or what really moves you during a game, that kind of thing, which is a really interesting concept, but that does start to blur the lines on like where is that creepy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I'm all for pushing the boundaries of technology. I guess it's just, if I found out that Microsoft or somebody, you know, Nintendo or whatever is watching me play my DS and they're like, wow, whenever he's storming through Luigi's mansion, his heart rate goes through the roof and he's clearly frightened of, I don't know if you play it, but it's spooky.
Oh, I bet. Ghosts?
No, ghosts are fine. Vacuuming?
Oh.
It's weird. I mean, it could be weird. So I guess it, at some point, does it just take one bad apple to either hack a company and steal all the stuff or to just do something that they shouldn't be doing?
Well, I mean, you just bringing that up honestly brings up a way bigger concern for me than any kind of metadata or, I don't know, possibly camera Kinect kind of usage. But like we've seen Sony's website be hacked like 2 times in the last 5 years, ton of credit card information getting out there. That I think is a huge problem. Big companies that are going to have archives of thousands or millions of consumers' information, like addresses, credit cards, that stuff needs to be secure, and it needs to be like corporate secure, serious, not gonna get spilled on the internet, and it's not. Like we've seen it happen twice with Sony fairly recently. That's very disturbing to me. Yeah.
A lot of companies are getting hacked all the time, and that's for credit cards specifically, but you're right. I mean, at some point, who decides, you know what, if this is valuable to insert company name here because mm-hmm. they can sell this data, maybe it's valuable to me and I can sell it if I can steal it. But I mean, there's got to be things that, I mean, do you think these companies are collecting this data just for the purposes of selling it or using it for market research or whatever? Or is there something about it that also makes, is there a benefit to us, the consumer, in some way? Like I know with the email thing, or like I was saying before, like at least I have targeted ads and I'd rather watch those than something that I'm never going to buy. But
is it being used to make better games? Are you asking?
Yeah, like better games or to make me aware of games in a better way?
I don't think so. I mean, even if the technology is there to do something like that, I don't think they'd be spending the money to use it that way necessarily. I think more likely than not, it is being used just to sell for the marketing information or whatever. Hmm. Maybe I'm cynical. I don't know. Who knows? But that would be my guess.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting. I mean, like I said, technology is going to keep moving forward, and it's only a matter of time before somebody figures out how to use metadata in new ways. And I would hope that if you're going to continue to use it, that they can. I understand you have to have your business need for it, and that there's money to be made for it. But if you can at least, one, tell me about it, make sure I'm aware.
That's fair.
And two, find some kind of benefit to give me that what's in it for me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay with it if it's done the right way, and it's got to be secure, like you said too.
Sure.
Shifting gears a bit, kind of on that line of technology and those kind of things, and pushing technology.
Okay.
We've been talking a lot about the Switch lately, which I'm sure anybody listening or watching this knows what the Switch is at this point. But just in case, you know, we might pick up some new subscribers.
Never know.
Never know. Somebody never might know. Think it's a karate company like DwnFwdPUNCH. I want to learn Taekwondo.
Self-defense.
Subscribe.
I'm all about
subscribe.
It. Yeah, that's true.
But we've been talking a lot about the Switch, which is a console to kind of go out on the road. You know,
right.
You could play on the go, which is not the first piece of technology that's tried to do this.
Mm.
The PlayStation Vita is something that has obviously tried to make that case for, you know, with the remote play. Like, hey, you could take your console games out with you. The Vita is effectively dead at this point, right?
More or less, yeah.
Have you played a Vita at all?
Have I played it ever? Yes, but I have never owned one myself.
I don't own a Vita either. I really wanted to pick one up for a while. I had a PSP for a bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had a PSP.
And I guess the PSP people hold in much higher regard than the Vita. But the Vita is effectively dead, at least in North America. I think it's still on life support in Japan. It's a weird crossroads now because Sony has made the statement that they don't know that the market is really there for what the Vita was trying to accomplish. But with the Switch coming out, if it's successful, does that breathe life into the idea of a Vita 2?
A Vita 2. I don't think Sony should bother. They just don't seem like they really have it down when it comes to the handheld thing. Nintendo's got it down with handhelds. That's their most profitable area right now.
It's our only profitable area right now.
Well,
actually, I take that back. I don't know what their health division is doing. You know how they kind of started working on health stuff for hospitals? It was an article on our website when we were working our website. But apparently you weren't too engaged at that point, but that's okay.
If you could have seen me through my PlayStation camera, you would have known exactly how engaged I was. There's a barometer for my engagement.
Yeah, Nintendo health equipment.
Okay.
It probably was not high on your radar. It's it's only a profitable part, but that kind of leads me to the idea of where has Nintendo done right where Sony did wrong? Why is the 3DS, I think every Nintendo handheld, why has it been such a winner when Sony has, had the PSP, which had an admirable showing originally. I think it eventually sold 80 million units over its lifetime, which is respectable, even though it took a while to get there, where the Vita has really, really floundered. Where did they go wrong?
If you ask me, I think it's the availability of games. Not necessarily the availability of games, but what games there are for the platform. When you look at a Nintendo handheld, you've got obviously things. Well, you've got Nintendo titles that are just like killer apps, one after another. The Pokemon series, you've got handheld Zelda games, some of which were remasters, but some which were originals, whatever that one, the paper one where he becomes flat. Second dimension or whatever. I don't know. Doesn't matter. Sure, my point is that there's Pokemon games, there's sick Legend of Zelda games, there's Mario platformers that come out for handheld games, or for Nintendo's handhelds. I can think off the top of my head all these games that are on a Nintendo handheld that I would want to play. If you ask me what I would want to play on a Vita right now, I would have no good answer for you. And, like, I really thought things were going to turn around when remote play was announced. I thought that that was going to be a huge thing, and it was just going to be awesome, and it was going to be like, whoa, I'm playing my PS4 everywhere I go. That sounds great.
You know, maybe it would have, because, I mean, remote play, I think, was announced for the PS3, if I remember correctly. It was originally a PS3 feature, and I think maybe if it ended up being what it was advertised to be, maybe it would have helped, because I think the impression was, when they start running those ads, that you can take any game you want, and mm-hmm. you can take it on the go with you.
Yeah.
In reality, remote play, I think, was only supported by like a handful of games on the PS3, which I do think was part of the problem, because consumers quickly got turned off to the idea, because if you're going to lure them in with this idea of taking your console on the go, and mm-hmm. then you don't get that, I mean, that's... If you're only buying the system for that and you can't do that, obviously you're going to be upset.
Sure.
And then word's going to spread. Going back to the killer apps thing, you bring up an interesting point, because Nintendo does have a lot of... It seems to me like Nintendo spent a lot of time in the beginning of the 3DS, or even the DS, or any of them really, where they tried to get all of their like Nintendo, big Nintendo properties, like they have people work on games, so this way there's a lot of those right away. Sony had big titles. I mean, the Vita, I think, had Persona, right?
I don't know for sure.
And I believe it had an Uncharted game.
It did have an Uncharted game. That is true. Which I heard was actually pretty good.
I heard it was not as great as the console Uncharted, but it was still good.
Right, yeah.
But like, those are big titles, and it had Killzone, I think, right?
They did have Killzone.
Which Killzone's a pretty big title.
It's a pretty big franchise, I guess, but I mean,
it's not an Uncharted or a Persona, yeah. But I mean, like, it's a notable reoccurring title. So they had some of these like big apps, you know, but they seem to kind of teeter off pretty quickly.
Yeah. And I mean, is it enough? Most recent Vita game that I'm even like aware of would be this game Gravity Rush, which maybe you've heard of.
I have heard of that.
The first Gravity Rush, I think, was a Vita exclusive until just recently when they remastered it for the PS4 and then released the sequel on PS4 as if to say, like, oh, people really like this game. Why don't we put it on something people have instead of releasing it for the Vita?
Yeah, I do think that in a way, I think Sony shot themselves in the foot in a way, because I almost wonder if the Vita was like too good of a console for its own good, because it was a pretty impressive piece of hardware. I mean, I think the thing was originally put together, wasn't it supposed to be like, I think it was marketed as like better than a PS2, like, you know, it was an evolution of a PS2, maybe not a PS3, but it was close, especially for a portable. And I believe, you know, I think we've talked before about like how ridiculous the like the memory cards were for that.
Oh, yeah.
I think what they did, I mean, the $300 price point it came out was really high for a handheld. I mean, like, but the DS was really high when it came out too. The problem is then you bought this really high expensive piece of hardware, and then you had to buy these expensive memory cards, which people, you know, were getting upset over. And I believe Sony did that to subsidize the cost, because that system probably cost them, especially in the beginning, way more than $300. So they figured, hey, if I can get the system in their hands, they'll buy the memory card, and we can recoup some of this money, because memory's cheap.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of people just kind of accepting it and going with it, I think that you upset a lot of consumers, which probably didn't help.
Sure.
And then by the time they started getting to a point where their costs were coming down and they can make a dent, they've already they got such a disenfranchised base that now it's like, well, let's not bother spending the time. Let's take Gravity Rush and let's have that studio work on it for PS4.
Yeah. Yeah, that could be. I mean, ultimately, though, I don't need to see a Vita 2 myself. I don't think any Vita owner wants to see a Vita 2, when right now the biggest complaint about Vita that I hear is that it's like there's no support anymore. So do people want to see a new Vita and be like, okay, great, now it's obviously completely done, it's done, and then I got to start fresh with a new system.
Here's where it gets interesting for me, though. Let's say, I mean, the Switch drops next month, okay? Again, this is a take your console gaming out with you on the go.
Yeah.
Let's say that this goes ridiculously well. Like, it's selling like hotcakes. People are going bananas over it. And that's the new thing. Mm-hmm. The new thing is like console gaming on the go. You would think that you would force not only just Sony, but Microsoft too, into a position where they have to consider how do they compete, whether it's with a new, like, you know, their own version of a PlayStation on the go or a Xbox on the go, or if their next system for the next generation becomes that kind of hybrid thing too. Because if that becomes the thing, are you going to let only Nintendo take that entire market share? If people are going to start moving away from the market you occupy to occupy this other market, you would have to adapt, right?
You would assume so. The problem is that this comes with a compromise. The Nintendo Switch, it's going to be very capable on the go because the system is there with you.
Right.
It's the processing, the computing is not done remotely. It's done there. The problem that things, you know, particularly like remote play with Sony had is latency. So if you're trying to play remote play with your Vita or, you know, on a Xperia phone or something like that, the reason I think it didn't really take off to what they were thinking it would is because there's latency there, and that makes a lot of games unplayable. The Switch is going to have that problem, but at the same time, the Switch doesn't have the power behind it that something like a PlayStation 4 Pro or this upcoming Xbox Scorpio is going to have. And I don't see a company like Xbox being like, well, let's tone things down from the Scorpio so that we can have a system be on the go. They're going to want the power in their hardware. That's what I think.
Yeah, but you're also looking at it from a standpoint of using the current systems. Because what if they are to build... Technology keeps getting better, right?
Sure.
I mean, you look at cell phones. It used to be that we had a cell phone that was this big. Like, I'm talking even like first smartphone. Like, you know, your first smartphone, well, it was small, and then we got bigger again. But our first smartphones were very thick, and they were space age at the time. But now they're like stone age, right? Because technology's got better. We can put more stuff into smaller packages. So the PS Pro is out. It's there.
Mm-hmm.
The Scorpio is probably done because you got dev kits probably already out and people working on whatever. It's probably not changing much. So those things are probably not systems that can go out on the go. The PS4, definitely not. The Pro, definitely not. The Scorpio, most likely not. But again, if Nintendo starts hitting this thing out of the park, or if Nintendo or if Sony and Microsoft think it's going to hit it out of the park, maybe they start thinking about the Xbox One 2 or the PS5, and they say, hey, we need to think of this. How do we cram all this stuff into a smaller package so you could take it with you on the go? And maybe it's not a docking system, but, you know, maybe it's just you set it down, you plug your HDMI cord into it, and then you could take your console with you everywhere. But if this is a space that people want, you would have to react to it, right?
Yeah, but I just feel like there would have to be a compromise made. And I see what you're saying. Like, we're not at the PlayStation 5. We're not at the Xbox 12.
I mean,
Xbox,
this could be
12.
2-3 years from now. But, you know, it could be a scenario where I think you're looking at it from a companion piece, like how the Vita was to the PS4.
Yeah.
You have your one console, and then you have your handheld. I'm saying maybe they shift altogether to do their version of a whatever, and by the time they're doing that, you can have maybe not a leap in power, but maybe you can fit the current power into that. I mean, look how much smaller the Xbox One got over, what has it been out for, 2 years?
Mm-hmm.
Was it 2 years, 3 years? I mean, like, you know, the Slim just came out.
Yeah, the Slim.
And you took this giant box, right? Because they made this big box, and they're like, well, we have to put all the stuff in here, and we got to make sure that it can ventilate. Mm-hmm. They took all that stuff, made it smaller, and they had the power brick in it now too.
Yeah.
So, I mean, things keep getting better and better. I'm just saying it's a possibility.
Yeah, no, I could agree with that. It's a possibility.
I think if I was an executive at Sony, I would be looking at the Switch launch in the first year or whatever as a free market research study, right? Look and see what Nintendo does, what they do well, what they do wrong. I mean, we all know that Nintendo's going to do some stuff wrong. But you can look at it and say, well, that's typical Nintendo stuff. But, like, here's all the things that they did right or wrong that is just not necessarily Nintendo-ing the situation. Right. Because if anybody's going to be able to adapt, it's going to be Sony. Because Microsoft has never done this before. So if somebody has to pivot, I think Sony could pivot to do something like that. And
that's if it comes to it. Better. I mean, this is assuming that the Switch takes off and that it's successful. And it as not. It stands right now, yeah, I really don't know. I don't know if it's how it's going to go. It might go bad for Nintendo. Maybe not.
It could. I'm just spitballing here.
Right.
So, well, that's it for news and whatever that other part was, because that wasn't really news. But that was our news-ish section. So coming up in just a minute, after the break, we're going to go over some video game Valentine's Day pickup lines. Figure we'll make it fun, right?
Oh, and they're going to work. They definitely work.
Definitely use them.
Yes.
Definitely use them.
Yeah.
See you in a bit. Welcome back. So this is Valentine's Day week.
Big week.
It's a big week.
Big week.
And I got to say, I know a lot of gamers. Some of them don't have their priorities on wooing the ladies.
Got to prioritize wooing.
Yeah.
Wooing is priority at least number three. I mean, top five.
The problem, I think, is that gamer guys or girls often want to find other gamers to kind of start a romantic relationship with. But that's not easy to do when you're just kind of out somewhere and you're trying to, you know, figure out that first, you know, the first line is always the hardest. That first hello.
Okay.
So I figure we could put together a service, right?
Sure.
Like a PSA. We're going to give you some video game pickup lines. So when you meet that guy or girl who you think might also be a gamer, you can throw one of those out there. And if they are a gamer, guaranteed to work.
Guaranteed.
Guaranteed, not to be guaranteed, but guaranteed.
Yeah, hold us to it, because it's not. We're pretty sure about this.
Like,
guaranteed.
On a scale of 1 to 10 about how confident we are, I'm like a 3 that we're about a 2 or a 10.
It's definitely in there.
Somewhere.
It's in that range, yeah. For sure.
I will make you one, all jokes aside, I will make you one promise. These will either work or they won't.
That sounds
right. That is my promise to you.
Okay.
Okay. So, you know what? I think while we do this, we got to kind of get the mood right.
You got candles?
No, but I think, let's cue some music.
Okay.
Yeah. I like this. All right. So we got some music, and why don't we bring the camera real close? We need a producer. Let's get this. Come on. Let's get this right here. Baby, you work for Bungie? Because I think you're my destiny.
I think the best way to do this, because you got to make an impression, you know. Girl, she wants to remember. You know, you want her to. So this is what you do. You lure her into a dark cave, okay? That's lit with like two open flames, and you tell her it's dangerous to go alone.
Something must be wrong with my auto aim, so I can't take my sights off of you.
Say plumbers are red, hedgehogs are blue. Have an extra controller. Let's do that again. Oh, you like creepiness?
Well,
plumbers are red, hedgehogs are blue. I have an extra controller. God, why can't I say controller? Oh, that sounds like that. Plumbers are red, hedgehogs are blue. I have an extra controller. Want to be my friend too? It gets better each time. Just wait till the 24th. Here we go for number 5. Plumbers are red. I'm just kidding.
Remind me of Sonic the Hedgehog.
You can be the Chun-Li to my Ryu. Can you be positive I'll love you forever? Sure you can. I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing over here. mushroom, because you're making me grow.
Okay, so that is DwnFwdPUNCHcast, episode 3. Those were great, weren't they?
Guaranteed work, so yeah, they were great.
I feel like we have really done a good thing today.
I'm glad you feel that way.
So from all of us here at DwnFwdPUNCH, I'm your host, Jason, my co-host, Topher, over here. You can follow me at Sergio Armani on Twitter, or at DwnFwdPUNCH, and that's at DwnFwdPUNCH, all one word. Topher, why don't you tell everybody where they can follow you?
Follow me on Twitter, at CobraDactyl. If you're lucky, you'll see me put a tweet up. It's kind of like the Halley's Comet, where it's like, oh my god, that happened one time in my life. So look out for that.
If you haven't subscribed to the YouTube channel yet, please make sure that you do. Like this video, subscribe, share it with your friends. We want to build this up so we can keep giving you the videos that you know you love. More of this. Punch that like button, will ya? Alright, episode 3. Signing off.
Pulling out.
Rest in peace at work.